all sing it with us.
Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
Good morning to all you mamas out there. I hope y'all have a good day today. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your love, Lord, and we thank you for this day. We just ask you to be with us this morning, Lord, as your word is taught. Be with Brother Mike as he brings your word. Lord, we thank you for Waylon. Thank you for his efforts in this church, Father, and Lord, just bless him. Lord, just be with each one of us, Father, as we learn your word. Lord, just help us all to be that witness that we need to be for this world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
What a great day when we get an opportunity to come together and celebrate the Lord on this Mother's Day. And so much good God is doing, and we're thankful to Him for the great things that He is doing. And this morning, it's always a privilege to see these baptistry waters be stirred, to know that God is doing something in people's lives. I always clarify to our folks who come and follow the Lord believers' baptism that, first of all, this baptism is not what saves you. We're only saved by one thing, and we're saved through faith, by grace through faith. You know, the Bible says that we give our hearts to the Lord Jesus Christ by trusting Him, repent of our sins, and then He forgives us. This baptistry is basically like giving your testimony. It means you walk in here and say, I'm now a new person in Jesus Christ. I've been buried with Christ, raised to walk in a new life. It's a picture of the old person going under and the new person coming up. And so today we celebrate baptism here in the Lord's house on this Lord's morning with two young ladies who've made decisions recently. Y'all come on. Last name. Is it Lexus or Lexi? Lexus, like the car, huh? Yeah, okay, I thought so. I just want to make sure before I said that. Lexus Thibodeau. Bet there's some South Louisiana roots in that somewhere, probably. And Lexi came here some weeks back. She's been coming to our church for a little while now and kind of nailed down her decision with the Lord and had never followed the Lord in believers' baptism. And so she comes today to make that decision public. Is that right? Yes. Have you asked Jesus to come into your heart and forgive your sins? Yes. Because you've done that, the Bible says, I can baptize you as my sister in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We're buried with Christ and raised to walk in a new life. God bless you. We're proud of you, girl. It's a little cool, but it's not as bad as it was last week. Tell me what your last name, I forgot.
M-I-L-E-S.
Oh, that's right. And this is Tammy. Tammy came, I believe it was last Sunday or Sunday before last?
Sunday before last.
Walked this aisle, said she wanted to trust her life to the Lord, be baptized, follow the Lord in believer's baptism. Is that right, Tammy?
Yes.
You've asked Jesus to come into your heart and forgive your sins.
Yes.
Amen. And we're glad to have her mom and dad here today witnessing her baptism. And so, Tammy, because of that profession of your faith, I can baptize you as my sister. And so I do that now in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We're buried with Christ and raised to walk in a new life. Amen. Amen. God bless you, girl. All right. All right. Well, that's what it's all about. It's about baptism and seeing people make decisions to trust the Lord. Brother Waylon, I turn it back
to you. All right,
let's
stand together. What a wonderful way to start a service, amen. Let's sing together.
I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how He gave
His life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about His groaning, of His precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is to Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about His healing, of His cleansing power revealing, how He made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. Somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is to Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion He has built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is to Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. And because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds the future, and life is worth the living just because He lives. God sent His Son, they called Him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He bled and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because He
sweet to home, our newborn baby, and fill the pride and joy he gives. But greater still, that calm assurance this child can face uncertain days, because he lives, because he lives. I can face tomorrow, because he lives. All fear is gone, because I know way to victory. I'll see the lights of glory, and I'll know he reigns, because he lives. I can face tomorrow, because he lives. All fear is gone,
that time again, the time that we celebrate all the wonderful women that helped us be all we can be. I'm talking about moms. So moms.
M is for the many things she gave me.
Hey. What you doing?
I just thought we might do a song for the moms for Mother's Day. Hi, moms. Hi. Hi, mommy. This is for you, mommy. M is for the many things she gave.
We get it. M is for the many things she gave us. We get it. That's very cute.
Oh, you're pretty quick for a bald guy. Everyone join in. Oh, means
that. I just thought that we'd do a heartwarming message for all the moms out there instead of a campy little song.
Oh, means that I owe her all I owe.
Okay. You do it your way. I will do it my way. Moms, we owe you so much. Thank you for being there.
T is for tender, sweet caresses. H is for her hands that made a home. You've made a home on the range.
Okay, stop it.
She did make a home on the range. You probably called it like a stove, but we had a range at my house. And she made
that word home, oh, that means so much. We still long to be in your presence. We still long for you to be proud of us. And yes, we still long to come home.
Okay, this isn't working.
What?
No. You're faking it.
I am not.
You're forcing the
tears. No, it's real.
No. This does not work in any way. This works. The song works. This does not work.
I just thought we'd speak from the heart. That's what moms want.
You know what? Mom always liked you best anyway.
We don't even have the same mom.
He's everything you've done to help me. Like that time you helped me find my shoes in first grade and in college. And there was that time also that Tammy Cornball broke up with me. Crazy last name, right? But she was really a sweet girl until she broke up with me. And I was sad, but you made me feel better. You brought in some chocolate chip cookies and some milk. And you made, you know what? What can make me feel this way, mother? Talking about my mom, mommy.
And R stands for right. And right you always shall be, right in our eyes, right with the values that you instilled in us so sacrificially, and right in how you taught us to love God and love others. And so, mothers, today we say to you,
them all together, they spell mother, the word that means the world to me, the word.
I didn't like your meatloaf when I was five. It's not my fault, it needed salt, but that doesn't really matter. Happy Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day.
Just doesn't seem right for me to have to follow them. But anyway, we do want to take just a moment and recognize our moms this morning. And thank you, Mom, for all you do for the family. I thought about the subject I'm preaching on this morning, when God made moms. And I found a poem pretty closely labeled like that. It says, when God made a mother. It says, at the dawn of time, God needed someone he could trust to love his precious children. And so God made a mother. I thought this was really good to have this worked in today, since Supreme Court justices and everyone else here lately doesn't seem to even understand the definition of what a woman is. I thought I might give clarity to that subject today, that at least you might have an idea why God made moms here today. He said, life will often be harsh. I need someone with a gentle touch, someone who can brush a tear from the downy cheek of a newborn and gauge a child's temperature without the aid of a thermometer. I need someone who has a special knack for soothing, who can kiss away pain and soften blows, and someone who will hold her child's hand firmly until she has to release it tearfully on the first day of school. And so God made a mother. I need someone who will care enough to gather daffodils and put them in a vase, and so everyone in the house can enjoy the first blossoms of spring. Someone who will care enough to rummage through the mismatched sock pile in hopes of finding a match. Someone who will make birthdays extra special, sing silly songs with her toddlers in the car, and who will actually want to go on a school field trip to the insect museum just to be close to her child. God thought, I need someone who will play Christmas carols on the piano, someone who will decorate gingerbread houses with the kids and wrap gifts and deck the halls of Christmas. For nothing in all my creation will be able to make Christmas as special as a mother's will. So God made a mother. I added to this wonderful poem just one verse that I thought it needed. And my ad was this: when God needed to fill the earth with others, he knew he needed someone different from a man. So he made woman with all the necessary parts for reproduction, which defines a woman as distinct from a man. For those that today seem to wonder, what's the difference? Does it really matter? Well, I'm going to tell you, it makes a big difference in reproducing and replenishing the earth with children. Amen? And moms are prepared to do that. And so if you know anybody that's struggling with with what's the difference, have them give me a call. I'll help them make sure they understand what's the difference. Amen. We want to give you something, moms. We want to give you something on this day. We have some folks who will come, if you would, and help me pass out some little gift books, some devotional books for our moms today. Just a little way to say, you know, used to we had deals where we sometimes would recognize the oldest mom. Half the moms didn't want to tell us how old they were. Y'all go ahead. Raise your hand when they come by if you're a mom. And so they didn't want to tell us how old they were. So that created a little bit of a problem. And then we said, well, we're going to give a gift to the moms who have the most children. Well, sometimes we'd have three or four different moms that had the same number of children. So that created a problem. We didn't know how many gifts to buy. And then we thought about the other solution to that. And by the way, these gifts are for moms, period. It doesn't matter whether you're a visitor or a member today. You raise your hand. But then we thought about maybe we'll give a gift to the mom that was the youngest there. Boy, that creates problems. Maybe she's very, very young And so we just decided it'd be better to give every bomb something today, even if it's just a smaller gift, to say we appreciate you, and hopefully it will invest, be an investment in your future as a mom. Moms, we do appreciate you this morning. We'd like to pray for you. Why don't you moms go ahead and stand for us right here? Just the moms. I want you to stand long enough for us to pray for you. You guys passing out the booklets can look around and see for sure who all these moms are now. As soon as we get all those books passed out, we'll say a quick prayer.
He wanted to give one to the ugliest mom, but I talked him out of it.
Well, that was just it. I didn't think I'd have anybody to give one to, so that didn't work.
Good, huh? Clever. Good save.
If we're running out, you got any left? Got a couple more if you need them. He needs them on there. No, they got them. I think they got them. Let us pray for you, moms, and we do appreciate you so much. Father God, we just lift our moms today. God, we're grateful that on this day, their day, they could have said, I just want to stay home and sleep and rest. But they chose to come on and worship you today. We know that you created moms. You made them different from men. You made them with a heart. And God, you gave them a different role in the home. And we're so glad you did, because so much of what they do, men just don't enjoy. And men don't do it very well. So God, we thank you for our moms. And Lord, we ask you today to bless these moms. We ask you, Lord, to pour out the windows of heaven upon them, Lord. And God, they're such an important part of your kingdom and the kingdom's work, and such an important part of this church. We thank you, Lord, for the role they play here. For we would not be the church we are without these mothers. So today we thank you, Lord. Bless as only you can. And God, will give you the praise, the glory, and honor. May these moms be honored today, but even above them, may you be honored today is our prayer. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
Do you feel the world is broken?
We do.
Do you feel the shadows deepen?
We do.
But do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through?
We do.
Do you wish that you could see it all made new?
We do.
Is all creation groaning?
It is.
Is a new creation coming?
It is.
Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst?
It is.
Is it good that we remind ourselves of this?
It is.
Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? is he worthy of this?
He is.
Does the Father truly love us?
He does.
Does the Spirit move among us?
He does.
And does Jesus, our Messiah, hold forever those he loves?
He does.
Does our God intend to dwell again with us?
He does.
Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. From every people and tribe, every nation and tongue, he has made us a kingdom and priest to God to reign with the Son. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy? Is he worthy? Is he worthy of this?
He is.
Is he worthy?
Thank you. If only you knew how short life would be, what would you do? What would they say when God called you home? What would they engrave once you were gone? I hope they would see what I've done in my life, who I've cared for, and how I've survived. I hope they'll say, she loved more than anything else. She loved with all of her heart. She she believed in, she loved, oh, she loved. She loved the Lord and served all her life, a sacrificial mother. She gave all she had, and through every trial made life much sweeter because of her smile. Everyone will see what she's done in her life, who she's cared for, and how she survived. I'm sure they'll say she loved more than anything else. She loved with all of her heart. She loved everyone she believed in. She loved. She loved everyone she believed in. She loved, oh, she loved, oh, she
job. Well, amen. Thank you, Miss Roxy. You know, not only did she do a good job, I thought Kevin did a good job a while ago on that song. Good job. Good job. Well, let's let the children go out for children's church at this time. They've got a lot of events back in the back today. All right. We'll be in Genesis chapter 1 if you want to go ahead and turn your Bibles there this morning. Just going to start by reading verses 27 and 28. When God made moms. I want to say a special appreciation to some folks who don't always get to come in here and sit down with us, and that's our security team. You'll see them outside walking around some. In the weeks like I've had this week, I appreciate the security team being out in the foyer. I kind of made the world mad at me this week, but that's okay. That's all right. It's going down to the Capitol and dealing with some of these issues we're dealing with right now. It just, I am lost. I am at a loss when we can't get our legislators to say that to a person, to anyone really, whether heterosexual or homosexual or whatever, when you go in the classroom, if you're teaching math or English or science, stay on math and English and science and don't get off into your lifestyle and what you think is right and start promoting your agenda in the classroom. And that was shot down this week by the legislature. So, no, we don't want to ask anybody to do that, you know. And so I'm just amazed. I'm just in a world where I don't fit in anymore. And anyway, we didn't know if some of that crowd might show up here today. And so I appreciate the security team out walking around. And what a great day it is for moms to celebrate God's creation of moms. Now, ladies, I hate to tell y'all this morning, but I'm going to break the bad news first. Here's the bad news. You were just an afterthought. You were just an afterthought. I mean, God made dads. He made Adam. He went through, he made all the other animals. And then he said, well, no talking back. No talking back in this sermon. I hear y'all over there. Then he decided to come back and make woman afterwards. That's another part of what Brother Whalen added to the sermon this morning, so we'll come give him that credit with that. The Bible says here in verses 27 and 28, and I said what I said jokingly there. Don't worry about standing, it's real quick. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female, and half in between, and two-thirds one, and one-third the other. And is that what it says? It doesn't say God created them, and you can change from one to the other if you want to. Doesn't say that. He created them, male and female. And then God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth, subdue it, have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every other living thing that moves on the earth. And of course, we know that's what God did. And so, the Bible tells us that then the story kind of begins in chapter 2 of breaking it all down. But it tells us he went through and he looked at everything that had been created and he said, this is good, except one thing, and that was man. And when he looked at man, he said, it's not good that man would be alone. For there's male and female, birds and animals and all kind of creeping things, and there's a need for the female. Man can't be alone. Obviously, he couldn't replenish the earth, could he? He couldn't fill the earth with more people if there's no woman involved in the process. And so God went back and, as an afterthought, created woman. That's kind of where that theology came from this morning. No, it's just a fact that God saw an imperfect plan, didn't he? And he created the rest of that story. Some have said God just wanted some quiet while he created everything else, and then after he finished, he created woman. Now, some said that. I didn't say that. Randy said that, and he's leaving, going out right now. He didn't know I was going to include that in there, but thank you, Randy, for putting that in there. I appreciate that addition to the sermon. Let's pray. I'm on one this morning, as you can tell already. God, as we look at the Scriptures today, we are reminded that you love us. And God, you gave us a reason to laugh. And God, so many funny things happen in life. And God, help us to have a cheerful heart. Help us to be a people who, even in a world that's changing, to still be able to smile, to still be able to find hope in you. And so, Lord, today, speak to us about the home. Speak to us about moms and dads and what the home should be in your eyes. For we know, God, you teach us in Scripture that the home should be the closest thing to heaven on earth. Help us, Lord, to make it that. Help us, Lord, to see our responsibility to raise the next generation. And so, Lord, we ask you to bless the reading of your word today and let your Holy Spirit take it and teach it. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Just a few things about scriptures today. And by the way, I know Miss Kathy's not here right now, but she sure did a super job with our breakfast this morning. We'd like to thank her for doing that for us. And we sure appreciate her contribution. When God began to fashion the home and create the home, I pointed out four things today of why God made woman. First of all, he made her for man. In Genesis 1:27, as we read a while ago about the creation process, how God created them male and female. And then the scripture talks more and more about that. Because the scripture says that part of the responsibility now for Adam and Eve was that they would go and they would replenish the earth. That they would go out and fill the earth. You can say, well, how many children did they have? The Bible doesn't tell us. It just says they had many more, names a couple, three of the kids, but doesn't go on and tell us how many children they had and how many children their children had. But it's believed in these early days they probably had a large number of children. And then their children had large numbers of children. And of course they lived to an exceptionally old age. And because of that, God used them to create. In fact, science has found, there's a lot of things science has not found that people would like for them to find. But science found an article in Newsweek magazine, I have a copy of the article, that can trace the DNA all the way back to one woman, Eve. Did you know they can trace your DNA all the way back to one woman, Eve? And it's important that you understand that. That even science backs up what the Bible says. Most folks didn't think that was so, and that could be proven, but it is. And again, if you want to see a copy of the article, I have it in my office. Without her, man could not fill the earth. Without her, man could not eat, clean the house, or dress himself every Sunday morning. No, wait a minute, I put that in there. That wasn't out of a scripture verse. Somebody said, Brother Mike, can you cook? I said, yes, I can. As long as the toaster and the microwave works, I can cook. Beyond that, I don't know how well it would be. Two things about why God made woman for man. First of all, two facts about that. She would be equal in her position with that man. She is equal to man in that position with family, in the family. In Genesis 2 and verse 21, I'll be using some verses out of chapter 2. It said, the Lord caused a deep sleep to fall on Adam, and he slept, and he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh in its place. Did you notice where God got the bone that he would begin the process of creating Eve from? Someone said he didn't get it from his foot where he could step on her. He didn't get it from his head so he could rule over her. He got it from his side because she would be close to his heart. And she would be one that God would use in a very, very special way to fulfill the role and the calling and the place of man in the home. They are equal before God. Galatians 3:23 says before the Lord that both male and female are equal in the eyes of God. Now they have different roles, they have different responsibilities, but they are equal before God. Equal in their position, in their love, and equal in their appreciation of God and how God uses them. They may have some different responsibilities. And yet God has placed a man, whether you like it or I like it, God has placed a man to be the head of the home. That may make you mad. You may say, I don't like that. Take that up with God right after church. I'll be dismissing here in just a few minutes, all right? And you can take that up with him. He's called the man, and not that he has said woman's not capable of doing that, but God said, I'm going to hold a man accountable for being that protector, that provider, that prophetic man in the home that becomes a spiritual leader. God is holding men accountable for being there. And so we look at that today. Genesis tells us that they were to have dominion. They were both to take dominion over all the other animals in all of creation. And yet there have been some significant needs. Man is just not complete on his own. There's so many things that he can't do. So many things that he needs help, and so many things that many times the woman is much better at. So the second thing I would say to you is she's not only equal in her position, but essential as a partner. She's essential. Chapter 2 and talks about that in verse 18 when it says of her that, and the Lord said, it is not good that man should be alone. I'll make for him a helper comparable to him. Comparable to him. Now, I don't know about you, but for many, many years, I've been doing preparations for weddings. We have one coming up this weekend, by the way. James and Anna out there, and you're invited to come be a part of that. I think everybody's invited, right? Can come be a part of that. And I was telling them this morning, y'all got just a few more days to back out. Just a few more days to just say, enough is enough. I'm not going to go through. Just a few more days. Listen, if I can talk them out of it, they don't need to do it anyway. Amen? But anyway, it's important. Through the years, I've known couples. I've explained things to them about the differences, and there's mega differences in men and women. There's emotional differences, as we can all imagine. There are physical differences, as we can all imagine, in our lives. But she would be a helper fit for him. I have found that a lot of times couples come to me, many times when they're wanting to get married, I'll find many times they're different in a lot of areas. You may think they'd be just alike, but one of them's going to get there 10 minutes early and the other one's typically 10 minutes late. Hello? One of them's kind of well organized and the other one can be a little bit sloppy if not careful. Amen? I see some wives shaking their heads back there. Yeah, y'all ought to quit being so sloppy. I'm telling y'all, y'all need to fix that. But there's just a lot of differences there. He may be good at math, and she may be good at some other subject. He may be the one that keeps the books in the family. But you know what I found? That God always seems to put someone with us that's able to be strong in the areas where we're weak. Because God wants the home to be a beautiful example of wholeness and completeness. And here we see the home that God envisioned. One that is equal, where they both serve in an equal position before God, and one where they are essential to each other. A second thing I'd like to say about this marriage and about this home and about woman, the moms that God made. He made her for man, yes, but he also made her for marriage. Do you understand that? If at all possible, God made woman. It says there in verse 24 of chapter 2, therefore man would leave his father and his mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. He made them. That's God's expansion. If everybody stayed in the home, we'd have to have bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger homes, wouldn't we? And God didn't say for everybody to stay in the home. Of course, we realize sometimes that has to happen for various reasons. But yet, ideally, God says it's ideal for the man, that woman, to leave their homes and to be joined together. And that word cleave to one another, or to be joined to one another, it literally means to glue them. It literally means to glue them together. And when that glue dries, guess what? You can't pull it apart. It's glue. You can tear it apart, but you can't glue it, unglue it. And so here God's plan was for them to stick together through the good and the bad, through the good times and the terrible times. And God had a plan on this oldest institution, which, by the way, this oldest institution on the face of the earth is under attack today. Almost every modern day movement is anti-traditional family. And we need to realize that the enemy would love to destroy the home. And here, because man was incomplete, man needed a helper to come alongside him. Because man was incomplete, God made marriage. He started the home. And we don't want to admit we need help as men, but we do just a little bit. No one was good at everything. Nobody could do everything. Nobody was able to do everything, even the process of having children. And she came along and completed man. She helped him do those things that he was not good at. And helped him think through the issues of life. And so because man was incomplete, he needed a helpmate. And because man was incapable of a lot of things, particularly reproduction, no matter what is said today, reproduction requires a male and a female. Unless you use some kind of scientific thing, but it still requires the female part to give birth to a child. You can't take a man and place ovaries in him and uterus in him and produce a child. There's a lot of funny things going on out there, but it can't be done naturally. Therefore, what's going on is what the Bible calls what is unnatural. And so there, and anytime we start with those things that are unnatural, we need to be real careful where we're going with that. It means it's not intended by God. There are things that we can't do very well, men. There are a lot of things that we need help with. There are a lot of things around the home. One of those in having children, one of those is raising those children. You know what I found through the years? That the dad may be the head of the home, but I found the mom is the heart of the home. I found she's the one that the kids want to run to when they scratch their knee. I'm telling you, I have kids that love me. But you just let them fall down outside and scratch their knee up. And I'm going to tell you something. I can go running to them, but they're going to bypass me and run to their mama. Makes me mad every time. So we're going in there. I can kiss your bobo just like she can. Go on in there. But no, she's got to give them a hug. She's got to put the Band-Aid on it. But I guess that's just the way God made it. Amen? Is that like saying amen, Brother Chuck? Amen. I saw that finger. I thought maybe you was bidding on something at auction. There wasn't nothing for sale. I just want to make sure. Number three in your outline today, why God made moms, is He made her for man, He made her for marriage, and He made her for motherhood. Now, I realize saying that right up front, there's some who maybe aren't able to have children. And I understand that. And that's one of the most painful things for a mom who wants to have children, and if she can't. And I'm so in touch with that. I even hate to bring that up. But God said to them in Genesis 1:28, be fruitful and multiply. When possible, when that was possible, God said, multiply. Don't just, you know, today, things have changed a lot, haven't they? I remember the day when, you know, both my mom and my dad's family, they got one, got seven children, I think the other one nine, if I'm right about that, and they large families, and you just don't see a lot of large families anymore, do you? Everybody says, you know, and part of the reason is in the agricultural family of years gone by, that a child meant significant income for that family by the time they were 18 years old. Now, you young people, I want you to listen to this. By the time that child was 18 years old, and it with money a lot smaller back then than it is today, that child meant it a minimum of at least $15,000 to $20,000 per child per family when money was a lot smaller than it is now. It meant money for the family. And why? Some of you say, why was that? Because they didn't get to lay in the bed all day long and play on their iPad. They didn't get to live in front of the TV screen. They didn't have Facebook. They didn't have all the... And I know the moment I said that, them kids are saying, he's so dumb. Children don't get on Facebook. They don't care about Facebook. Facebook is old news. But whatever they do, they literally had moms and dads that said, you're going to go out and work in the garden today. Or you're going to help feed the cows. Or you're going to help take care of things around here. And so a child meant someone to help the family eat. Put food on the table. Nowadays, a child will cost a family, by the time they're 18 years old, in excess of $100,000. It will cost a family that much. Not add to the kitty. It will cost the family that much. I think all of you children ought to consider paying your parents back. That's really what I think. But I don't know. We'll just talk about that. Take out a student loan and let Biden cancel it. That's what you ought to do. Just take out a loan and let somebody cancel it. Then the rest of us will pay it. But here's what we realize is that that it's cost money today to raise. So a lot of people have a lot fewer children than they used to. They decide to not have as many because it costs a little more to have children. But I want to tell you something. And some of you may say, oh, it's really hard. It'd be hard to have that many children. I know some people today that still have a lot of children, and I'm going to tell you, they're some of the most well-mannered children I have ever seen in my life. And I think sometimes it's because those older kids learn early on. They have to help take care of the younger kids. And when they do that, they learn some responsibility. I think responsibility is a good thing. And no matter how many children you have, and I used to hear them say, those who had a lot of children nowadays who would follow Bill Gothard and others, they'd say, you know, the Bible says you need to have your quiver full of them. Well, let me tell you, as an archery man, I've seen different size quivers. Amen. I've seen big old quivers, and I've seen little bitty quivers. Amen. That just hold a few arrows. So don't tell me it's about the quiver size, because I don't know how many arrows you can put in there. But anyway, it's important to say that as you do have children, moms, as there are children that come along in a family, understand you're the heart of the home. That's the first thing I've noticed on here. You're that heart. You're going to take those children and you're to help shape them to have a good heart and to send them out into the world. The Bible says they're like arrows in the hand of a warrior in Psalms 127. They're like arrows in the hand of a warrior, and you send them out to greet the enemy. Let me tell you something. There's a lot of enemies out there today. There's a lot of enemies of the home today. A lot of enemies of the family. And we realize today that God says our children ought to be shaped. And listen, I've had some old arrows that got bowed before. And if they had a bow in them, you could shoot them like the cartoons. They just about shoot them, and they just about come back and hit you in the rear end when you got through shooting them. They were so crooked. And he says it's our job to shoot straight arrows that go out there and hit the target where we're launching them to go into this world and to make a difference. Mom, you teach us about love and hugs and patience and sometimes things Dad's not really on top of his game at, as he should be maybe. And second thing, she's usually the hope of the home. I think about that. Many times Dad has to be the bad guy. I know my mom used to always tattletale on me, and she would tell my dad about how I had done something wrong that day, and Dad would come home and beat me half to death. Amen? Any of you dads ever have that responsibility to be the disciplinarian of your home? Let me see your hands. Let me see. Ed, you had to do that, didn't you, Ed? Yeah, I noticed they all show up on Mother's Day, Ed. I noticed that. It's just like that's the only busy day in the prison for the phone lines, they say, is on Mother's Day. Nobody calls on Father's Day from the prisons to their homes. But Dad gets to be that disciplinarian a lot of times, and Mom, she's the one who says, yeah, I tattled on you, but I'm so sorry. I didn't know your mean daddy was going to whip you today. I didn't know he was going to do that. How important it is that, Mom, you teach those kids those things that we're just not great at teaching them, and how you teach them how to just dust them off and put them back on the road again, doing the things they need to do. And it's an amazing thing, because that's what God tries to teach us, how to keep going and not give up. A fourth thing I want to mention in our outline today, and I'll close with this thought. He made her for mentoring. One other verse of Scripture out of Genesis that I wanted to bring about. Mom's one of the great responsibilities of yours. Over in the book of Titus, before we closed, I just didn't want to miss that. I want to talk about your spiritual aspect in the church and the community. In the book of Titus, it shares with us some thoughts about moms and some thoughts about how your work goes in the church and in the community, some in 1 Timothy and in some in Titus. Titus chapter 2 and verse 4 says this, if I can get these pages apart here. There we go. This is what it says about those wives. It says that they should admonish the young women to love their husbands, to love their children. This is what the older women are teaching the younger women. To be discreet, chaste, homemakers, good, obedient to their own husbands, and that the word of God may not be blasphemed. In other words, that your home would be healthy when you're out in the community. That others would see a godly home, a home where two people love each other and the parents love and watch over their children and raise those children to the glory of God. 1 Timothy 5 gives some other insight to that. 1 Timothy 5 and verse 13, if you want to turn over there and see what it says. It gives us the significance of the home, and then we'll close. Here's what it says in verse 13 of 1 Timothy 5. And besides, they learn to be idle, wandering about from house to house. And not only idle, but gossips and busybodies, saying things which they ought not. In other words, Paul is saying to Timothy there, make sure that they're just not talebearers, that they're not just running around, getting themselves involved in everybody else's business, and sometimes causing dissension in those places and carrying tales from here to there. She is to do two things. First of all, to model godliness. When he said for them to be reverent in behavior, not slanderous, not given too much wine, as are drunkard, teachers of good things, he is saying, and all the things that were said that we read there, he is saying for them, I want them to model godliness. I want the older women to model to the younger women godliness, how to be a godly woman. And the second thing, I want the older women to motivate the young girls and the younger women to motivate the teenage girls or smaller girls. We had a program in my last church for a long time called Apples of Gold, where the older moms would bring in groups of younger moms, and they would just go through and share. They would talk about modesty. They would talk about things the Bible says about the role of a godly woman. And then they would share things with them, like they would share things about cooking. Little secrets like when you finish cooking this and you finish cooking that, save the grease and you keep all that grease in a can or jar or something and then you can reuse it later. And if you got some green beans left over, save that to later go in a soup or something. You know, don't be wasteful. And just a lot of wise things that young girls needed to hear, needed to learn. And I thought that was what a great example of the older women sharing with the younger women. They shared a lot with them about modesty and how to dress modestly and how to put your makeup on so that can inappropriately say something about you if that's not done properly. But it's so important that was stressed. And then after they had done all the young moms, they brought in the teenage and college girls and they taught them these things, that they might also learn how to be godly young women. And so when he talks about those young ladies, he says they need to be mentors. They need to model modesty and morality and teach them how to make the most of their home and how to lift up their husbands. There's no greater reward for a mom than her kids to grow up, and the Bible says to call her blessed. No greater reward than to know that her kids walked with God. This next generation of moms need your input, moms. I've shared with you some lately what's going on, and there's a lot of change going on in a lot of the younger generation right now. There's no desire for God. There's no desire for spiritual things. The number's down now below 25% of the younger generation that really says they have a real faith in God. What's happened? I read an article this week. It says what's happened is we've stopped as parents having a Christian biblical worldview, where that we look at the world through the glasses of God. We look at life, the choices we have to make. We look at life the way God looks at it and wants us to look at it. And friends, if we move away from that, listen, as we move away from that, our children are going to move away from that. If they don't see it in our homes, they're going to think less and less about God because they never hear us talk about God. They need to know how God helps them make choices and decisions in the home and how they seek to please Him above everyone, above anything else. God first. Dads, I want to say to you on this Mother's Day, there's nothing greater you can give to your wife than to love God with all your heart and soul and mind and strength. And if you'll love God first and love God first ahead of everything else, even her, you'll have plenty left for her. And what you give her will be of great value. I'm here to tell you it all begins with God. Let's get Him first. When I counsel with young couples, I say, listen, ma'am, you got to focus on yourself. You got to get yourself where you love God more than you love this guy. And I look at those girls and I say, you've got to, the guys, and I say, hey guys, you want her to be a great wife. You want her to love you with all of her heart. Then you need to love God with all of your heart. And God will direct you on how to love her with all of your heart. We get it all mixed up, don't we? We think, there's literally people who've quit coming to church. I'm not talking about here, but they've just, people who stopped serving God because they think they can do better. They can spend more time with their family on Sunday, and they don't need to spend time with God. They just need to spend family time together. I'm like, spend family time on Saturday instead of on God's day and give God this day. And so it's important that we understand that. Hey, moms and dads, but moms, I'm saying to you this morning, one of the greatest things we can do is point our kids to Jesus. Point them to Jesus. Come on, Brother Whalen. Musicians, you come. Here in this morning, it's one of the things on Mother's Day, I think one of the greatest things we can do is point our families to Jesus. Sadly, I'm afraid that's not happening in a lot of places. There's a lot of folks who claim to be Christians, but they're not pointing their families to Jesus. And oh, my friends, we are sowing to the wind. And the Bible says when we sow to the wind, we're going to weep. What? We're going to reap what? The whirlwind. If we allow ourselves to not give our best to the Lord, we're sowing some wild oats that's going to come up one day. And we're going to regret it because the next generation's watching what we're doing. And I pray that you are doing a good job of pointing your kids to Jesus. Let's stand together. This morning as we come to this time of the invitation, if you're here and you've never given your heart to Christ and you want to be saved, you come to me and say, Pastor, I want Jesus. Three little words, I want Jesus. Others of you maybe come this morning and say, I'm a Christian, but I want to come here and be a part of this church. Just come tell me. I just feel led to be a part of this church. And we'll see what you need to do to move your membership here. And whatever you need to do, the altar's open if you want to come and pray and talk to the Lord about some things. Let's pray. Father God, as we come to this invitation this morning on this Mother's Day, help us, Lord, to show great gratitude for our moms. Help us, Lord, to honor you and bother to bless you in our homes, by our homes. Help us to be better husbands that love our wives the way Jesus loved the church and gave Himself for it. And God, help us to truly be a family that might display a lighthouse of God here on this earth. Oh God, may others see Jesus in our home is my prayer. God, have your way this morning. Help us to be what you'd have us to be. In Jesus' name, amen.
Weak and wounded sinner.
Come on now, if you have a decision to make, don't wait on anyone else. The altar's open.
Raise your head, for love is passing by. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus and live. Now your burden's lifted and carried far away, and precious blood has washed away the stain. Sing for Jesus, sing for Jesus, sing for Jesus and live. Like a newborn baby, don't be afraid to crawl. Remember when you walk, sometimes you'll fall. Fall on Jesus. Fall on Jesus. fall on Jesus and live.
So much for being here this morning. If you'd like to speak to me about something here as we leave this morning, I'll be here at the front door. Please come by and just let me know how I can best minister to you. Maybe you feel like you have a question about some of this and questions about salvation. I'd be glad to make an appointment and come see you in your home. Okay? Thanks for being here this morning in the house of the Lord as we've had a great time in the Lord. No service tonight, so spend time with your family. Tomorrow night we will do outreach at 6 o'clock. Okay? We're going to do outreach at 6, so come be with us. Eddie, dismiss us, please. Yes, come up here.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning. We just want to thank you for such a great service we had today. Father, we just want to say thank you for just giving us the inspiring message that we heard so much from our pastor. Father, we just want to especially remember all of the mothers that are here. And Father, we want to think of those that's gone on to see you. And Father, we just pray that you continue to bless our church and see how we grow. Father, we love you, and we need you. This world has turned to turmoil, and we ask you to just take things over. We know you are the Almighty, can do anything possible. And in all things we pray, amen.